I think we can start now, right? We are live on YouTube.
Yeah, we're live.
Bhavna? So I'll start. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's session. I'm Yash Vijayvargiya. I am the content head of LawSeco, and I have with me Abhishek Parekh, who looks after all IP courses. Hi, Abhishek.
Hi, Yash. Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining.
Hi, Abhishek. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Yeah, so the idea of today's session is that we are going to be discussing trade dress and passing off. These are the two most common remedies. The idea behind trade dress or passing off is very simply that you should not be taking benefit of somebody else's hard work. What we are going to be discussing is that how these laws are dealt across jurisdiction. It is very important to understand that how trade dress, passing off, they are not looked just in India, but across jurisdiction for a very simple reason, right? Because you will be having companies which have established presence in one country. And as we are going through COVID and other things, companies are entering into foreign markets, and most of them have online presence now. So how they look, how they appear, this is what we base or decisions of buying on. So Abhishek today is going to be discussing and taking us through that how these different things are dealt across jurisdictions, especially. Yes, Ago, it is flickering. I'm sorry, I can't do anything about it. So anyway, Abhishek will be there, so he'll take it over from. So hi, Abhishek. So over to you. You can take them through this.
Okay, great. Thank you, Yash. So I have a PPT with me, which I will be sharing, and then we'll be, going through what our agenda of discussion for today is. So let's just begin.
Meanwhile, everybody can just introduce themselves and say what they are looking for the session. That would be really great for us, right? And also, we will be taking all your questions towards the end of the session. So whatever doubts you have, whatever things you are having, you just ask them right now in your chat box or through Q&A. Abhishek and I will be taking that towards the end of the session.
Great. So I'll begin with the PPT now. So as Yash said, that we will be discussing, it's taking a little time. Yeah. So we'll be discussing trade dress and passing of protection in US, India, and primarily UK. And so what trade dress is something that, we should be talking about firsthand. Before we get into that, what do you think is the idea behind trademarks? Why do trademarks exist? Trademarks are something which have to be capable of graphical representation. They have to be distinctive. They have to be able to, identify someone's brand. But why is it that the trademarks exist? There are basically two facets to it. One is the view from the side of the consumer, and the other one is from the seller. The seller would, of course, want that, his goods, whatever he is selling, is identified as belonging to him and no one else. No one else should be able to claim the similar identity as he has. Because then if that happens, then he would incur losses, because that would cause confusion. If, for example, let's just take the example of Parle G. If you tomorrow go to the market and you want to buy a packet of Parle G, you find a very similar looking packet, a yellow packet with stripes and something similar written on it. Aren't there chances of you, instead of buying Parle G, ending up buying that product? This will basically cause a loss to Parle G, because instead of the money going to them, it is going to someone else, and you as well, because you never intended to buy something else. You wanted to buy Parle G, but you ended up buying something else because there was confusion being caused because of the packaging of the product. This is what the primary intention behind trademark law is, that you do not want there to be confusion. You do not want people to be confused about the source of identification of your trademark, right? Your basically your origin of goods or services for that matter. Now, this is trademarks, but trade dress is what, as I've written in my PPT, that trade dress of a product is the overall appearance of that product, which includes its packaging, its color combination, or the shape of the overall goods. So while trademark is something which is just, you know, either a word or something along with the word, a symbol, which is like one particular symbol or word which the which a company or an entity would be recognized by, the trade dress would be the overall appearance of it, not just the words, not just the symbols, but the overall appearance of it. So now, you know, looking at the definition of trade dress, do you think that trade dress fulfills the purpose of trademarks essentially? What trademarks basically intend to cover is the fact that they want trademarks should be identified with the person that they belong to. Okay, that is the source of origination that you should know. Even with respect to trade dress, that is something that could happen. Like I said, that you know, you saw Parley, you did not see just the words which were similar. You also saw that the packaging was similar. There was this yellow packet. Maybe there was a girl also, maybe some different girl, but there was rather a girl. And there were stripes and everything was similar. So you got confused and you ended up buying Parle something else, Parle P, for example. So that is something that would be a problem for you as well as Parle G. So hereby we establish the fact that trade dress are equally capable of identifying your goods or services as belonging to you, which is basically the purpose of trademarks, trademark law, right? Now let's move on to the second slide. Basically, this is one of the cases from 1972, which stated this: goods of a particular getup just as much proclaim their origin as if they had a particular name attached to them. And it is well known that when goods are sold with a particular getup for long enough to be recognized by the public as goods of a particular manufacturer, it does not matter whether you know who the manufacturer is. So this basically is sums up what trade dress is and how it is something that protects you know, your identity. So this has been recognized over the years by the courts, by the jurisprudence has developed regarding it. Initially, protection with respect to trademarks or trademarks were seen to be typically just the words, but now it has extended to the appearance as well, because it has been found that it is not necessary that only the appearance is similar. The overall packaging, the overall package can be similar, the overall structure of like how the goods look, the overall design can be similar, and thereby it can also lead to confusion. Okay, now every product has a trade dress, but not all trade dresses are protectable. Why? Because, for example, if you just come into the market, you are selling cookies, you have a black box for cookies. Now, you've just entered the market, like I said. Now, do you think that you should have the right to have monopoly over it? Do you really think that your mark has yet become capable of identifying your goods or services with you alone? A black box, nothing very unique about it, just a black box. No, because there is no inherent distinctiveness, or it has not even acquired the distinctiveness. Like the second point says, the protection of a trade dress, either through registration or otherwise, is largely dependent on inherent or acquired distinctiveness. Now let's look at what inherent and acquired distinctiveness, what is the difference between these two. Inherent distinctiveness would be exercised by something which is predominantly unique, which is by the virtue of its creation, it was created in a way that it came out to be very unique. Instead of a black box, let's say it was it was something which was more unique of a packet, maybe some packet of a character, or it was able to identify cookies, the flavor of cookies in some way, very unique way. And there was like, there was no doubt that no one else has come up with that sort of a thing earlier. And so it would be inherently distinctive. Okay. It would be something which was distinctive through its very birth. But you can also acquire distinctiveness. Now, let's come back to the black box of cookies example. Let's assume that this black box of cookies has existed in the market for last 20 years. And everyone knows, like when they go to the market and they see it from afar, a black box, they kind of know that this is what we want to buy, and this is what we are looking for, and this is the brand that we like and we associate with, and so we would buy this. Now, even though this black box was not inherently distinctive, it has acquired the distinctiveness. The distinctiveness has been brought forth because of continuous use of this particular box by this brand, by the advertisement, by people buying it over and over and over again through the course of time. So when this happens, it acquires distinctiveness, and trade dresses of products which have acquired distinctiveness are also protectable. So let's, if we take the example of Parle G again, if Parle G was, because of the fact that it is selling these biscuits for so many years, and in the very same kind of packet. I remember Parle G used to come in a very filmy packet a while ago, but then it switched to a more sturdy packaging. But even then, the overall color, the stripes, the baby, all of those elements still remain the same, and people still recognize a Parle G as a Parle G. You do not really need to look at the logo. You do not really need to look at the very mark to know that, you know, this is what Parle G is. Okay, so inherent distinctiveness or acquired distinctiveness is very, very important when it comes to trademarks, and specifically when it comes to trade dress. Okay, moving on. Trade dress is often associated with products, but is not limited to the same. So like I was also talking about products for all this while, and it could be assumed that trade dress is something which only a product would have, a dress, something which is something, a packaging or the way a product looks, but that is not the case. Even a service could have a trade dress. Maybe a website wherein, for example, a matrimonial website, it's a service that they're providing, and they have this website which looks very particular, like which has a very particular getup, and you know that, okay, this is how it looks. Tomorrow, if someone else comes with another matrimonial website or a dating app, and they lift up the entire getup of this website or this app and apply it to their own services, this would again be an infringement of trade dress, even though it is applied to services. Or another example would be a restaurant. These days, there are so many myriad restaurants of different themes, train, jungles, and whatnot. So trade dress could also be like the theme of that restaurant or that cafe could also be copied by someone else. When that would be the case, then again, it's a trade dress infringement. It's basically you are passing off their trade dress infringement or passing off. We'll come to that later. But you are kind of riding on their goodwill. You're basically trying to make people associate with their goodwill, with their brand. You're trying to make people think that maybe this is a franchisee of this very restaurant, or you know, we are related in some way, there is some kind of association, and the brand cannot afford that happening, right? And even the people do not want to be fooled. They wanted to visit that particular restaurant, so they should be able to visit that particular restaurant, and they should not be confused with something else which is not that good. Maybe the food is not that good, which is not at par with what that restaurant is. So that kind of confusion should not be there in the market, right? So it is also applicable to services as much as it is applicable to products. The functionality doctrine limits the scope of trade dress. Now, what is functionality doctrine? This is a doctrine in the trademark law, which basically states that any kind of feature that provides any type of functionality to a product cannot be trademarked. So for example, the shape of a steering wheel cannot be trademarked because you cannot have monopoly over something that is designed in a particular way because that is how it is the most functional, right? Why else do you think that, you know, steering wheels have been circular for all this time? Because it is definitely more convenient. Although I saw a while ago that Tesla came up with a square steering wheel a while ago, and I don't know how is it going to be as convenient as a circular shape. But a circular shape, that circular shape provides functionality to the steering wheel, to the steering like mechanism. So that is why it cannot be protected as a trademark, as a trade dress. Similarly, the shape of a tap, it is shaped like this because it is very useful, like, you know, all those protrusions out of the tap. It is because, you know, it helps you to make a grip on the tap and then either like turn it on or turn it off. So it is again something which is functional. So anything which is functional cannot be trademarked or protected as a trade dress. Now some examples. See here, Reynolds wrap and Handy foil, aluminium foil. So it is completely, the names are completely different. Had Reynolds wrap filed a suit for trademark infringement saying that our trademarks are same, they would never be able to, you know, seek any kind of remedies because they are completely different. The words are completely different. But if you look at the whole packaging, look at how they have used the color red and the color blue, which is very similar. And imagine you walking into a store. Do you really care about the brand of foil wrap very particularly? Like maybe you bought Reynolds wrap for a while ago and you found that it was okay, and you just, the second time that you walked into the store, you just saw Handy foil and this aluminium foil, and you did not notice what is written on it. You just identify that, okay, this is something, this is a similar packaging that I used to see at my home while I was using this foil, and this must be the same thing. So you will end up buying this. Now, it might not be a big problem for you, or it might, you know, it might be as good of a quality as Reynolds wrap, but then it is definitely causing a loss to Reynolds wrap. Instead of buying their product, you're ending up buying this something else, which is basically imitated them. So this is something which should be stopped. Again, similarly, Gucci came up with shoes which were copied by Guess. And so I'm not sure if this image is like, this is something that actually happened or not, but for the sake of example, this is very fitting. So you see that, you know, these shoes look so similar that, you know, if you owned this pair of shoes and you saw this in the market, you might think that, oh, I already own these shoes, but these are completely different. Or were you to buy, you saw somewhere that, okay, these shoes are in trend. You went to the market, you saw this, and you ended up buying this. So this is problematic again for Gucci. Similarly, Fevikwik Quick Heal. Not much similarities with respect to the trademarks themselves, but look at the packaging. It is entirely the same. Like they have not bothered to make any changes. There are only very, very slight changes, and they have just used the same fonts. They have used the same color combinations and everything. And then they have, started selling it in the market. And in fact, even you, if you will go to the market and you will say, can I please have a quick Fevikwik, even the shop owner would not think twice and would hand you over a Quick Heal instead of Fevikwik. So this is something that, of course, the trademark law cannot afford, the proprietors cannot afford. Similarly for Starbucks and this Mount Rainier espresso milk, the marks are per se are not same, like what is written is not the same, but what is the appearance is quite the same. Like you might see that there's a coffee shop at the corner and you do not realize that it's Starbucks or not, you just enter and you just buy your coffee. thinking that it's Starbucks. So such things should not be there, and that is why protection is also granted to trade dress and not just trademarks per se, wherein we see that, you know, trademarks are completely different, but the trade dress, the entire getup, is very similar. So now, what is the position of trade dress in India? The Trademarks Act does not explicitly use the word trade dress, okay? But after the 2003 amendment in the to the Trademarks Act, the definition was made more inclusive, and the words may include shape of goods, their packaging, and combination of colors. This is basically Section 2ZB is the definition of trademarks in the Trademarks Act. And it now has these words, uses these words, shape of goods, their packaging, and combination of colors, which is essentially nothing else but trade dress. So the protection has now been accorded to trade dress and not just trademarks. The whole packaging, the whole getup of goods is also protected in India now. According to Section 2M of the same act, they have defined mark as well. What is the definition of a mark? And they have again included things such as device, brand, heading, label, ticket, name, signature, word, letter, numeral, again, then shape of goods, packaging, or combination of colors, or any combination thereof. Package includes any case, box, container, covering, folder, receptacle, vessel, casket, bottle, and so on and so forth. So then you also see that it's again, they have defined package, and they've accorded protection to package as well, and it's not limited to just the mere words. Okay, so even though the Indian trademark law allows trade dress to be registered, example is Christian Louboutin's shoes, which is basically a shoe which has, like, the outer soles of which are completely red, and they have been granted protection in India. They have a registration in India. They have a valid registration in India. There is nothing about it. It's just a color. If you will Google Christian Louboutin shoes, you will come across all these variety of shoes, of which the soles are red. They are visible because they are heels. So if you see the heels, the outer soles of heels are visible. So that is something which is a unique feature of Christian Louboutin, and they have been using it for a very long while now. So this is something that has been accorded protection to, and this is actually a validly registered trademark in India. Most of the trade dresses are unregistered, but still most of the trade dresses are unregistered. In such a scenario, how do you think can the proprietors protect the sources of identity for their brands? Now, the reason why a lot of trade dresses go unregistered is for a number of reasons. First of all, not a lot of people have that kind of awareness, or not a lot of people are looking for that kind of enforcement when they are beginning with a business. They are more like what they think is that, okay, let's just get our trademark registered, the words registered or the logo registered, and be done with it, and we'll see what happens. Second thing is that when they are using this trademark, when they're basically using this, whole package, then they are not really, they're just begin. Let's say that they've just begun. Now they have not acquired any inherent, they have not acquired any distinctiveness as of now, because they've just begun, and their product is not like, we took the example of the black box of cookies. Now the black box of cookies was not registrable when we just started, right? Because it was not distinctive. So a lot of times this happens, and they acquire distinctiveness over time. So what do you think can be done about this? Of course, these things cannot be left unprotected. Even though they are not registered, you cannot say, the courts cannot say, when, you know, someone approaches them that, you know, this is something that is happening, that sorry, your trademark is not registered, and we will only be dealing with registered trademarks. So even though there is confusion being caused, even though you are getting you are incurring losses, even though public is getting confused, we will not do anything about it. That is not how trademark law functions. So what will happen is that there is a remedy. So even though these are not registered trademarks, this will not fall under infringement per se, there is this remedy called passing off, which protects unregistered trademarks. Okay, so let's just see what passing off is. Most of the cases pertaining to the protection of trade dress, like we said, are filed claiming passing off of the prior user's goods or services. What do the words passing off suggest? When you say, when someone is passing off their goods as someone else's goods or services, then they are basically trying to create this impression among the public that they are no one else but the prior adopter only. So Parley G, Parley P was using Parley G. What was the intention? What do you think could possibly be the intention behind Parley G using this very similar set, getup? Because they wanted to confuse public. That is what the sole motive behind them adopting this trademark was, that they just wanted to confuse public and they just wanted to make make undue profits out of this goodwill that Parley G has attained, because everyone buys Parley G. Like when they see Parley G, they trust it. They know that, you know, it would not do anything very harmful to their health. It is something that they trust. It has acquired a trust among public, and Parley P was wanting to basically make undue advantage of that trust that Parley G has gained. So this is what passing off primarily is, that you are passing off your goods as someone else's goods, okay, or services again. So there's this, but as opposed to an infringement, when your trademark is registered and when you file for infringement, then what happens is that you just have to prove that there is similarity of products. Like one product looks similar to the other product, and that is it. The court will not ask you that if there is a lot of confusion being created, or if you're actually incurring losses or anything. If there is similarity, the confusion is presumed. It is presumed that because there is similarity, there will be confusion. But when it comes to passing off, what happens is that you have to essentially prove three things, which is the classic trinity given in the case of Reckitt and Coleman Products Limited versus Borden Inc. There are three things that you have to prove. First of all, you have to prove that you have acquired a goodwill. Goodwill is what? Goodwill is something that a brand acquires over the years, or if not, like there have not been a lot of years, there must be so much advertisement of generally happens because of use of the product or services for a long period of time. And so this is why this is what, you know, enables you to acquire the goodwill. So when you acquire the goodwill, you can and someone else is passing off your goods as theirs, you can go to the court and you can state this. It would be easier for you to state that, you know, our trademark is being passed off, because the court will also know that, okay, there is substantial goodwill for someone to want to pass off their goods as yours, right? Otherwise, if you are not really known in the market, you're no one. You have been selling some product. Maybe you have been selling a product for last 20 years, but there was no, this brand never gained any kind of goodwill, never attained any kind of goodwill. So then what will happen? There will be, basically, they will not be able to claim goodwill, right? You have to basically show that there is some kind of association. Moving on, there has to be some kind of misrepresentation. Now you have to prove that this person is actually trying to misrepresent their goods as yours. Goodwill you have established. Coming on to the second bit, which is misrepresentation, wherein you have to prove that this person is trying to misrepresent their goods as like your. They are trying to play with the psychology of the public. They are kind of trying to deceive the public in some manner. So that is something that will have to be proved. And then once, after you've proved that, you will also have to prove that you have actually acquired, that you've actually incurred some kind of losses, because there is someone which is using a similar trade dress or a trademark as yours, or an unregistered trademark or trade dress as yours. And once you prove all these things, then is when you will basically be able to claim passing off, as opposed to if you have had a registration, then an infringement would suffice. Okay, so this is what a passing off basically a passing off claim would have to basically entail. Now, these are some of the cases. Colgate-Palmolive and Company versus Anchor Health is one of the oldest cases with respect to trade dress. It is the most recognized one, in which there was these, if you remember, there was these cans that used to be very prevalent with respect to toothpaste, these powders of toothpaste. Some of my relatives used them. And I even remember today that, you know, there was a red and white packaging that was attributed to it, that was attached to it. And what Anchor did is that they came with a toothpaste, which was like the can of toothpaste was again similar to this red and white packaging belonging to Colgate. So now Colgate sued them for passing off and for basically riding off on their goodwill. So then the court basically held that, you know, this is something that would cause confusion. Despite the names being very different, the similarity in color combination was held to be enough to cause confusion. So if you see the names, if you look at the names, Colgate and Anchor, the names are very different, but still the packaging is, because the packaging is similar, this was held to be something which would cause confusion, although there was some like people were not very satisfied with this judgment, and it was criticized a little because people stated that it did not take into consideration all the aspects of the classic trinity. So that was there, but still Colgate was able to seek the remedies nonetheless. Sun Pharmaceutical Industries, this is a very recent case. Last month, towards the end of the last month, the court, the Delhi High Court, granted a preliminary injunction in favor of Revital. Basically, look at these marks. These are these look very similar, but this is someone else. This is Revital from Sun Pharma, and this is Nuvital from New Kind Healthcare. And an infringement plus passing off action was filed because they were also, this must be their you know, registered trademark, Revital. So this is, they are also a kind of, if you see, there are similarities with respect to the symbol and like the way it looks and also the words. So they claim passing off as well as infringement, and this was considered to be a problem. And the Delhi High Court granted an interim injunction in favor of Sun Pharmaceuticals. Now, this was the position in India. We shall now be moving to what the position regarding this in the US is. It's a little different than in India, and let's see how it differs. As to like the protection granted and the procedure in the US. In the US too, the product of packaging or packaging must be either inherently distinctive or must have acquired secondary meaning in order to enjoy the trade dress protection. So secondary meaning is nothing but acquired distinctiveness, basically. So these two are again the parameters on the basis of which a trade dress protection would ever be granted. Functionality doctrine is applicable here as well. They take it very seriously. Functionality doctrine is in fact like enforced even more cogently in the US than in India. Trade dress is usually registered on the supplemental register rather than the principal register. So now this is one of the like, you know, primary differences when it comes to trade dress and trademark law in general with respect to India and US. There's something called a supplemental register, and then there's something called a principal register. So when you apply for registration of a trademark, it can either be registered on the principal register, it can either be go to principal register or the supplemental register. So principal register is something which the USPTO considers to be very sacred, very pure. So what they do is that they will only put trademarks in the principal register when they think that it is very distinctive, when they think that there is no scope of confusion, when they think that all the criteria of registration of a trademark have been met with this particular trademark, then they would put it into principal register. Whereas when we talk about the supplemental register, what happens is that they go on and also put trademarks. They basically allow trademarks to be inserted in this register, which are not per se very distinctive. But if they feel that it could still be like, you know, accorded registration, maybe they have been using it for some time, they have not acquired the distinctiveness yet, but they have been using it for some time nonetheless. So the court will, the USPTO will consider it, or even the applicant by themselves, if after, you know, getting the objections, they feel that, you know, there is no chance of getting them, getting their trademark into the principal register, they will think that, okay, let's just at least go for the second best thing. So they will go to the supplemental register. So now what is the difference between principal register and supplemental register is that if you have registered your trademark into the principal register, there is more protection which is given to you. Again, like I was talking about, talking about passing off and infringement in India, in the similar manner, there is a greater burden of proof on you when your trademark is registered in the supplemental register, in the sense that you will still have to kind of prove that your trademark is a valid trademark, wherein if it is on the principal register, the validity is never going to be questioned. The remedies available, everything with respect to, principal register as opposed to supplemental register is, there are greater protection granted to principal register. There definitely more which is there to supplemental register. So, Yash, do you want to add something?
Yeah, just I will have a couple of questions once you conclude.
Okay, great. Yeah. So, but still, why do you think would people go for a registration in the supplemental register is because you can still use the, you know, R, the registered symbol when you are going for a, like your registration is there in the supplemental register. There would still be infringement. You can still go and state that, you know, you are infringing my trademark. So that is there. And there are other protections as well. That is why supplemental register is still better than no protection at all. For example, if someone else tomorrow wants to file a trademark and they file a similar trademark that is available even in the supplemental register, then even that would be cited by the USPTO in their office objection report. And they will state that this is similar to this trademark. Whereas if your trademark was never registered, your trademark just existed in the US, no matter how similar it is to something else, some other trademark, it will not be cited by the USPTO ever in the office action report. So that is something because of which a supplemental register is still better than no registration at all. Moving on, the Lanham Act as opposed to the Trademarks Act specifically uses the words trade dress under Section 43 of the Trademarks Act. All right, so Section 43A, subsection 3 states this: in a civil action for trade dress infringement under this chapter for trade dress not registered on the principal register, the person who asserts trade dress protection has the burden of proving that the matter sought to be protected is not functional. So that is something that has to be there. Then one of the other subsections state that in a civil action for trade dress dilution under this Act for trade dress not registered on the principal register, the person who asserts trade dress protection has the burden of proving that the claim trade dress taken as a whole is not functional and is famous. And if the claim trade dress includes any mark or marks registered on the principal register, the unregistered matter taken as a whole is famous, separate and apart from any fame of such registered marks. So now here, if we see, there are two things. One is trademark infringement, trade dress infringement, and the other is trade dress dilution. So the difference between infringement and dilution is that you can only claim infringement when the opposite party, when the other person is using their goods in the exact same goods as you, like the classes are the same and they're using it for the similar purpose. But as opposed to that, when it comes to dilution, you don't necessarily need to have the protection under the very same class. Dilution is basically accorded to, like, you can claim dilution when your trademark is more or less a well-known trademark. You have acquired such distinctiveness, you've acquired such popularity in the market that even though the classes of goods are dissimilar, there is still a scope of confusion being caused to the public. For example, you are selling hair dye, the other person is selling cereals, breakfast cereals. the trademarks are the same, but there is difference. So now you will not be able to, there is difference with respect to the classes. You will not be able to claim trademark infringement, but you will be able to claim trademark dilution nonetheless, trademark or trade dress dilution nonetheless, if you have acquired that kind of popularity among the public. So this is this, these are the provisions with respect to trade dress in the Lanham Act. And it is not that you, it is still, it would still be called infringement. Unregistered trademarks are still, one would still go and seek remedies for infringement when it comes to unregistered trademark in the US as opposed to India, wherein you cannot use the word infringement when your trademark is not registered. Moving on, these are some of the cases. So in Qualitex versus Jacobson, this cleaning pad, which has a very distinctive color, was said to be distinctive, was said to be protected, what was protected under trade dress. Okay, similarly like Christian Louboutin's shoes. In 2 Pesos Inc. versus Taco Cabana, particular case, the theme of the restaurant was protected as trade dress. And the interesting thing is that it was said to be inherently distinctive, as opposed to something which would have acquired distinctiveness, which is more protectable when it comes to trade dress. So this was kind of a deviation, and thus there was a lot of discussion about this judgment, because trade dress is of more or less like associated with the distinction being acquired over time, but this was held to be acquired distinctive because this restaurant was said to have acquired distinctiveness because of the way it was basically, everything, the whole getup of the restaurant, there was specific chandeliers, there were specific carpets, there were specific tables, the way the chairs were, what the waiters wore, how the whole decor of the place was very unique. So someone else copied that, and then it was the restaurant was basically granted trade dress protection. In Walmart stores versus Samara Brothers, the requirement of secondary meaning to protect a trade dress was given greater emphasis on in this case, and the unique design of children's apparel was not granted trade dress protection. So now this kind of deviated with 2 Pesos a little, in the sense that the court stated that inherent distinctiveness is something which is very important when it comes to trade dress, and acquired distinctiveness is something very important when it comes to trade dress, and so we will only grant trade dress protection when any brand or any product, because of use continuously over and over and over again, has acquired this distinctiveness, has become unique, has become identifiable. So these are some of the cases. So this is how, the US law and the Indian law differ. Now coming to the UK law, the UK law is pretty much the same as what is the basically status of trade dress in India. It is referred to as something very minute, but it is trade dress is called get up in the UK. I'm sorry for my dog, he's completely banging the door, so I'm really sorry for that. Trade dress is more commonly known as get up in the UK. This is something, the position is similar to that of trade dress in India. Again, applicability of the classical trinity, all those three grounds have to be met in order for someone to prove that their goods are being passed off. And this is one of the cases that came to the court not a long while ago. It was 2014, I guess. I've stated 2014. So it stated that mere confusion. Now look at these bottles. Don't you think that they are very similar? And don't you think that confusion could be there? Someone else could pick up Miracle Oil instead of Moroccan Oil when they go to the market. The court basically stated that confusion is not enough. There has to be a misrepresentation. So if we talk about the difference between these two things, what confusion is basically that if you're just getting confused, you are just wondering. There shouldn't be just wondering that, okay, is it in some way associated with this other product that I saw? That will not suffice when it comes to passing off. There has to be a misrepresentation in the sense that you would actually have to end up buying that product instead of the product that you intended to buy. So that kind of standard is something that would be applied to when the court is looking at a claim for passing off. So if we look at this as compared to what the court did in Anchor versus Colgate, we could state that, you know, the court did not really apply the classical trinity to the best possible extent. And because we can be, this argument could be made that somebody who is going to buy something that they are going to apply on their skin, that they're going to use for their skin, they would exercise enough prudence to just turn the product around and look at how it looks, what it says. And if it instead of Colgate, it says Anchor, they would put it back to the shelf and look for Colgate instead. So the court did not take that into consideration. And one unique thing that the Colgate versus Palmolive judgment said that was, in India, a lot of people are illiterate. A lot of people do not really know how to read. So looking at that, they will not be able to identify, they will not be able to basically state which is Anchor, which is Colgate. So that is something that would cause confusion. But here in the US, in the UK, the classical trinity was applied most strictly, and protection was not granted to Moroccan oil because of the similarity with respect to trade dress. So this is pretty much it with respect to what I intended to discuss. I would hand it over to Yash if he'd like to add more.
This was really enlightening, Abhishek. I really like the depth in which you have covered all these topics in such a short duration of time. For somebody who even doesn't have a background, I'm sure they are able to follow what most of the things you've said. The only thing would be, I really want, with an example, if you can explain to us, I suppose, and this is where most of the confusion arises, right? Because when trademark is defined, when we see the definition of trademark, they include shape of goods, they include trade dress, they include everything now. It's a very, very expansive definition that has come. Now, for instance, if I have a product, say a water bottle. Now, when I am going there, when I am going to the court, especially in India, for a passing off action, or say trade dress action. Now, inherently, passing off is a broader remedy. It's a common law remedy, right? As far as I understand. But and this is where ambiguity arises, right? Because when you're talking about trade dress essentially comes to the same thing, that I'm passing off a good as somebody else's good. For instance, if this is a water bottle. So if I'm claiming that there is an infringement of trade dress, or the trade dress has been copied, or if I'm saying that it's a passing off action, more or less they talk about the same thing, right? So I want to understand, as per your understanding, that how do we reconcile the difference between trade dress? Because when we say trade dress is part of trademark, isn't it too expansive? Because of the way, if you and especially in light of what you have discussed with regard to US and UK position, right? They have clearly differentiated that. But in India, we don't differentiate. We put trade dress in the trademark definition. So practically, how does that work here?
Indeed. So that is why that is something that is definitely there that they have included. So section 2ZB, the definition of trademarks, includes the definition, like within itself includes trade dress itself. It never goes on to say that, okay, this is what trade dress is, and this is how we will protect it. They have not allocated something different to trade dress at all. Whereas US has recognized the fact that, you know, it's trade dress, we might not be able to register it on the face of it. So the thing is that in India, they kind of also use similar practices in the sense the registry will not register a trade dress.
That's what I was coming to. That
unless and until it has acquired. Sorry, Yash.
Yeah. So see, exactly my point that here it is exceptionally difficult to register a trade dress, right? That if you at the end of the day, practically, if you have to go for trade dress, it will always be a passing off action. That because you have copied the trade dress, now you're passing off the good as somebody else's.
Yes.
It does not do any benefit, right? Even if we remove the trade dress from the definition of trademark, does it change our enforcement mechanism, or is there a
Yes.
specific benefit that Indian law accords?
Not really, not really. If that would have been the case that, you know, they would have removed it altogether from the definition, then the problem would have only been in the fact that, you know, see, trademark law, India is a user-based country. So for you to use your trademark, you don't have to register it. The trademark law never
Absolutely.
says that you have to register your
Absolutely.
trademark.
Same thing with
So
passing off action.
when you are using the, yes, exactly. So when you've just started using the trademark, whatever is the, you know, whatever is it that that the consumers are recognizing your brand with respect to, the courts will have to kind of accord protection to them, because the very purpose, when we come back to the basics and look at the purpose of trademarks, it is that there should not be any confusion. And if in even though you have protected your trademark, you've registered it, everything is very proper, the other person is not even interested in your trademark. They're interested in how your product looks. Then what will you do about it? So you will have to go on and seek protection, a broader protection with respect to the trade dress. So that is something that they can still state that, you know, trademark is like our whole product is still like the way it looks is still our trademark. So that is why we have a right over it, in the sense that, you know, because you never said that we need to register it. So now a court is the protection. So that is why they go and seek passing off. Otherwise, if it is a registered trademark, like Louboutin's, Christian Louboutin's shoes, this red sole, then they would just go and say that this is infringement of our trademark. So that is how it plays out. But of course, the way the Lanham Act has done it is better, in the sense that they have defined it very properly, and they have kind of let us know that, you know, see, there is a
Yeah.
chance that your trade dress will not get protected. So that is something that they have kind of
Yeah, so that is a problem with Indian IP laws, because I have
given.
also personally seen that there are a lot of overlapping provisions. So when you are going for
Yes.
enforcement, like suppose, and this is something we also faced a problem, that when we have to enforce, say, a design of a bottle or something, so you have a protection under Designs Act as per novelty that it should not be prior published. But in case you're not able to do that, then you go under trademarks. Then you go, if that also doesn't work
Yes.
out, then you have a passing off claim. So there are too
Yes.
many overlapping claims that come here because of that, right?
Yes,
And
yes.
also, I also believe that trade dress, the way Indian trademark registry particularly does it, the standard is very, very high for you to accord a trade dress protection under the Trademarks Act. So they do the same thing with Shapes trademark. That to get
Yes.
procedurally, it is very easy to give a Shapes trademark. They will process everything. But when you go to the court and say that this, I have a
Exactly.
trademark on this shape, like it is
They will cancel
impossible.
it.
It is impossible to get
Exactly.
an injunction on that. So it becomes a very procedural thing.
Yes, they will go back to considering whether the registry did the right thing or
Thing or
not.
not.
Whereas when it comes to the US, they will not question the USPTO's
Yeah, there
decision.
should be a presumption that once something is registered here,
Yes.
again, what happens is, मतलब practically ये है कि even if I don't register that shape trademark and I go under a passing off, or I register a shape trademark, eventually in the court, my argument is going to be same. The standard of proof, the judicial, in commercial courts also that's happened, because most of the commercial courts, if you see, they are localized. So the judges do not even understand the intricacies. So for instance, we were doing this case. So the judge was not even aware that there's something called Shapes trademark. So at least for first 2 months, whenever we used to say trademark, we used to be like Shapes trademark. We are not talking about the brand name. We are talking about the Shape trademark. And he was like, Shape pe kaisa trademark hota hai?
Oh my
Ye
God.
toh aisa hai. So this is a very peculiar problem that is here, that even if you're registering after except the trademark, because most of still the understanding, commercial courts have been given this power of IP law, but still the understanding is very localized, except I think Delhi, that aapko passing off hi karna padega. Eventually you have to prove that a person who is going to see it, they will get confused. That is the standard, imperfect recollection.
Yes, so they a lot of times they people use when they are going for trademark infringement, they would also include the word passing off.
Always. This is always like never. I was told this by I think one of the lawyers we were working that never ever have a trademark infringement claim. It is always a trademark infringement and passing off. Always a designs infringement and passing off. Because if you can't satisfy that threshold, then you come down and satisfy at least this threshold. So, yeah.
And this should not be the case. Like, of course, judiciary should know what a trademark.
Because this becomes like a forum shopping, right? At the end of the day, at the end of the day, it is forum shopping. कि अगर अच्छा ये नहीं हुआ तो हमको ये तो दे दो. This becomes very problematic, right? It dilutes the law.
Exactly. That is definitely something that needs to change. And
I think the way UK, EU and US have done, it makes a lot more sense, especially the way US have done. So you have very clear protection, and at least there is some presumption that if I have taken the effort to get it registered, I've done the separate act, then the enforcement mechanism will be completely different.
Yes.
Right? So that is one thing we should ideally be moving towards. What do you think?
Yes, in fact, that would be great. This kind of uniformity. They are not confusing people that okay, ye passing off hai, ye infringement hai. Everything is infringement. But there is something which is an unregistered trademark. There is something which is a registered trademark. They've defined everything. They've put in proper procedures for everything. So it's very, very uniform, and it is very easy for people, for lawyers as well as for proprietors to be able to enforce the rights. So this is something that is definitely long due, and there should be definitely some kind of clarity brought to the act. That is definitely okay. There.
So now we have a couple of questions. I think most of them are tangential, but still we'll just take them one by one. So what is the penalty for infringement of trademark? Vishaka, you should see the Trademarks Act. There are different kind of penalties. There's a financial penalty, everything. Abhishek, you would like to take the questions? Just go through the chat.
Sure. So what if somebody owns the brand of
there's some voice lag from your
Jyoti's in India and okay let me just try and change my connection. Should I just switch off my video? Maybe that
No. Now you are audible. It works.
Okay, great. So you are basically asking that would the protection be extended to the US? So technically, no, because trademarks and intellectual property rights in general are territorial in nature. So what you have protection for in India will not be considered as a valid registration in the US or the UK. But if you have started selling the products in the US or UK without getting it registered, without getting them registered, then you have again, like we were talking about right now, that you don't need to specifically go and register your trademark. So if you have started using it, and if you are the prior user, if someone else was the prior user, then it would be a problem for you. But if you are the prior user, then you can go ahead and claim remedies.
And in fact, you will find settled precedents where even if somebody has a registered trademark and you can show that you were a prior user and there was a goodwill, then your claim will be above that registered trademark. You can always question that. So that is one thing you have to keep in mind. That prior user is the idea. The idea of IP law is very clear. Whoever has put the effort, that person should be benefiting from it. And anyway, just to bring in the context of our discussion, the idea of having today's webinar was to expose you that how it is very important for you to read trademark law, just not in isolation that you are doing. And this goes for all intellectual property courses, right? That you can't just be reading about Indian law. You have to understand how the law is happening in US, that how the law is being developed in UK, EU. Because in our cases also, these are very new legislation, 2099, and the law is not settled. So most of the time, if you see, foreign judgments are often cited and the courts will be relying on how the law has developed in different jurisdictions. And that is where I think Abhishek, we are having a boot camp on from 14 to 16th, and Abhishek has worked really hard in developing a course on US law. So Abhishek, would you like to talk about that?
Yes, absolutely. So even though you know, intellectual property, we always say that it is principally the same, like, you know, trademarks is trademarks, copyrights, what is copyright is copyright, what is patent across jurisdictions. But when you get into the, you know, when you go deeper, you realize that there are a lot of procedural differences. And you see that, you know, it is really interesting for someone who is interested in intellectual property. Then it is really interesting to see how these things work out, you know, even though, said, like we talked about trade dress. So trade dress, what is trade dress is similar, is the same in India, US and UK, but the procedures are different with respect to how India deals with and how the US deals with. Similarly, you know, procedures with respect to everything is different. And there is of course uniformity across jurisdictions with respect to some things, but of course the procedure differs, the way things are dealt with differs, the practices differ, the way USPTO conducts its functions differs a lot than how the Indian Trademark and Patent Office does that. So that is also, so these things, like while I was developing this course, I primarily honestly began with this idea that it is going to be majorly the same as India. But when I got to research a lot about, you know, the US laws and the laws in the UK, I found that there are indeed some dissimilarities, there are some differences. And to know all of that, to know about all of that is very interesting. And someone who, you know, wishes to kind of expand their practice in the sense that they maybe want to someday go to some other country, US or UK, for example, or they want to pursue an LLM in intellectual property about that. So if they want to do that kind of thing, it is something that can come in very, very handy to have a good knowledge about the laws, so that you will not be surprised all of a sudden, or you were not thinking that, okay, I'm just going to the US or the UK and I'm going to study trademark law, which is all the same in India and the US, but there are differences and they're really interesting. It is really interesting to note how that folds out. So it's
Paridhi has a very, very interesting question on this, Abhishek. Prior user.
Is prior user also territorial? Like
there are a lot of judgments on this also, Paridhi.
But I have not used it in US as such. Will I get the benefit of prior use that is related to India? So there is something called trademark spillover or cross-border reputation that sometimes come into picture. But very, very strict proofs would have to be given you for you to be able to state that your prior use in India or in the US should be considered in the other country as well. You will have to really prove that the people of this country also, you know, associate your brand with, you know, what is being done, so that, you know, people should think that, okay, achha, ye wali franchisee India mein bhi aa gayi, or like, you know, for example, Starbucks was never in India. If Starbucks was never in India, but everybody knew about Starbucks because of multiple sitcoms, multiple, you know, blogs about it, there is Starbucks is pop culture. So if you know that, okay, Starbucks is exists, and tomorrow someone else opens a Starbucks in India, then of course it would be very detrimental to Starbucks. It is not something that you know Starbucks should endure. Then is this when, you know, the court will consider that, okay, there is a cross-border reputation or the trademark has spilled over to the other territory, and then they will consider affording protection to someone who's been using this trademark prior.
So spillover trademark also, just to add to what Abhishek is saying, is something which will most specifically be applicable to luxury products or products which are very high value, because those are the places the consumer base is such that they buy globally. So in that case, it would be easier for you to say that this product has a global reputation. But otherwise, if you're talking about generic consumer products, then it becomes very difficult from a common person's perspective, that who is not exposed to that audience, who is not exposed to that information, because court will always be considering this also. So there will always be argument that who was the intended audience for you, right? So in that case, if you're talking about spillover product, you'll have to be very specific that my intended audience is somebody who is a global consumer, who always goes to different countries and buys things. So then it becomes easier in that case.
There is also a lot of counterfeiting, especially with respect to luxury goods. So that is why, you know, this is where the spillover can come into picture, and you can state that, okay, your brand is being diluted, your brand is being basically, someone else is basically passing it off, or any such thing. So there will be stricter proofs which you will have to give to the courts.
In fact, Abhishek, on this only, just to take the conversation forward and talk about more about the career and IP law. Mm-hmm. So there's a recent trend about freelancing, right? Because if you are working as a lawyer who is mm-hmm. who is helping startups, because now after COVID especially, I've seen that a lot of softwares, a lot of industries are going out of India, and vice versa, that companies are coming globally because people are selling online. There is easier trade of good and everything. So how do you see those opportunities? That does it benefit to serve global clients? Is it a better way to fast track your career than earlier just joining a law firm and serving national clients? Because this time the exposure is better. And what are the freelancing opportunities that are there?
So, you know, this is something that can be made a great use of, specifically with IP, because as I said that, like we said that there are differences, there are dissimilarities, there are also a lot of similarities, and it is very interesting to note how, you know, these things differ, but the base remains the same. So basically, intellectual property essentially is a universal practice. It is something that, you know, once you've gotten hold of, it is something that you that will come easy to you. It is not something that will take a lot of time for you to grasp. But of course, there are a lot of things that you would have to learn in order to do that. And because of the fact that the remote culture is so prevalent these days because of COVID, maybe one of the only good things that have come out of this atrocity that COVID is. So this is something that can be made really good use of, and there can be great opportunities that you can get hold of, great opportunities sitting here in India, but still getting a global exposure. So this is definitely something that one should ponder upon. Somebody specifically, you know, interested into intellectual property should think of that, you know, can they get the exposure? Can they get that kind of exposure and also that kind of money? So it is something that could be beneficial to people who are just, like, you know, looking to earn some bucks out of what their practice is or what they are doing right now in India. Here probably they can also do for clients in the US or the UK. Similarly, they people who want that kind of exposure, who want to go abroad, who see themselves going to abroad, practicing abroad, or even to go for an LLM, like I said earlier, it is something that would expose you tremendously to how things work there. And of course, it will give you an edge over students there who have, who would not have that kind of knowledge. It would also, of course, help you with respect to your applications, your statement of purpose. You can state all of these things, that this is something that I've already done. So that is why I'm sure about this. When they are evaluating your statement of purpose, they're basically looking at what it is. Are you really sure that you want to do this? So when you state these things that you've already done all of these, you know, all of these things, then they would definitely, your chances of being considered get higher, become higher. So
go a step ahead to what Abhishek has said, that earlier there was this trend that people who are working in law firms, especially in intellectual property, mm-hmm. or who are looking for work in intellectual property, they would always want to do an LLM abroad because that is where, you know, the deep understanding of IP law comes. But now I strongly think, and this is something we have been having conversation, Abhishek and I, mm-hmm. that the better way for you to be do the work, that get exposed to work which is in different jurisdiction rather than doing an LLM and then focus mm-hmm. here only, because there you are doing the practical aspect, you are working on finer details, you are doing the work, not just reading the theory and supplemented with theory. And that is where the course that Abhishek is developing focuses on, right?
That is definitely there. Like, that is what the whole ethos of LawSeqo is, that we want people to actually go and do it rather than just, you know, reading up these provisions and writing endless articles. Of course, there is very much importance of academics, but the thing that you will be doing for the rest of your life is that you will be practicing. So if you know that is something that you want to do, then you should look at it at a, as a like more overall perspective of it, and not just focusing on learning provisions, but you should focus on learning provisions in consonance with actually doing the kind of work that would give you immense exposure, and that would give you immense experience, without hassling somebody who is working in a law firm for crazy hours. So that is something that is definitely,
and also that really expensive loan that you will come back with after your LLM.
Of course.
Not to put out
that is
on the side. All right,
that
so
is of course there.
Yeah, so this was just a conversation starter on the opportunities that you will have in international law. And we also wanted to give you a brief about how the relevance is there of cross-jurisdiction work in IP law. We will be taking this conversation forward in our bootcamp on 14 to 16 in career opportunities in intellectual property law. Go to our LawSeeker page, register for it. It's a free online bootcamp. So you don't have to pay anything. I would strongly suggest that if you're that prioritizes, at least attend it to know that different opportunities are there, even if you don't want to work with us. But we are going to be giving you a lot of steps on how you can develop your freelancing career in international career opportunity. Abhishek and I are already working and helping the team in getting those things in order. So looking forward to see you. You can go through our web page and register for that. Abhishek, this was really good. Thank you so much for such an enlightening conversation and doing
thank
this at such short notice.
Thank you, Yash. Thank you for
thank you guys. Let us
thank
know
you, everyone.
You can reach out to Abhishek or me on our LinkedIn page, and if you have any comments,
yes,
if you like something, if you want us to improve, just post it on our LinkedIn page or on LawSeeker's LinkedIn page as a comment. Thank you so much.
Thank you guys. Have a happy weekend ahead. Bye.
Yeah, and please stay safe, take care
stay
of
safe.
Yourself.
Yes. Okay. Bye.
Abhishek, you can